All right, party people. So today we're gonna do part two of our 2011 build.
And we'll see how the very first shots from this gun go.
So for those of you that didn't see the first video of this series, I basically made a video last week talking about how this series is gonna kind of progress. I'm kind of trying to take a multiple angle approach to the 2011 build. It basically has two simple goals: to keep it as cost effective as possible and to keep it as simple as possible for the average person that could build one of these. And what I mean by that is we didn't wanna do an 80% because you gotta go buy $600 and something worth of jigs and tools. So therefore my goal is to keep the tools as basic and as cost effective as possible. And so we picked up a 100% 2011 frame. I'll make sure to put a build list for everything that we're using today, including tools and parts and stuff like that. But here's the thing, even though it's 100% frame, when you get the slide to put on there, it gets stuck and it won't go all the way on. And so in today's video, I'm gonna show you how you can take the measurements with your calipers and how you can use basic tools to fit your slide to your frame. In addition to that, I'm also gonna cover how you can convert your slide to a bull barrel configuration. There is a couple of parts that are needed, and this is one of those little parts that makes my build personally cost a little bit more. You don't have to do this. You can get a basic barrel with a barrel bushing and it will be a lot cheaper, but this was something that I personally wanted to do for my build. As an example, a barrel bushing is this little fella right up here in the front. It twists out of the way and it holds this plunger in place for our recoil system. And those are great, but you need a special tool in order to make them work. A bull barrel, on the other hand, is a barrel that gets wider as it gets to the end. And when it gets to the end, it essentially takes up all the space in the slide, eliminates the needs for special tools to remove the barrel bushing. The problem kind of comes in now though, is how do you trap the recoil system? And because if there's no bushing there to hold it, then what do? I'm gonna show you how you convert your slide to accept it. There is minimal filing that we have to do to this slide. Don't worry, even though we're filing it, it doesn't make it irreversible. So if you wanted to still use a standard barrel bushing, you're still gonna be able to do that. And then here in a little bit, we're also gonna talk about, just a little bit, this Rock Island Armory Tac Ultra single stack 9mm that was sent out to me by the folks at Brownells, because I'm using this as a way to reverse engineer this build because I've never built a 9mm 1911 or 2011 before. So let's dive up close. Let me show you how we do this, and then we'll go over a little bit more about this. We're gonna be fitting the slide to our 2011 frame. And as you can see right here, it doesn't quite fit. And that's because even though this isn't an 80% frame, you always have to do fitment with 1911s or 2011s in this case. Basically, anytime you want to assemble a 1911 or a 2011, you're basically building it. The only difference between this frame and an 80% frame is, with the 80% frames, like I mentioned, a lot of money that you gotta spend in jigs. And I have all the jigs to do the operations that we're gonna do today, but I really wanted to try to do this with hand files and stones and stuff like that, because I wanna make it as affordable for you guys as possible. Because not everyone has the money to go buy all the parts and then go buy all the jigs. I'll also have a build list for the tools that we're using. And then I'm also going to be using shooter lube to keep everything clean and lubed up, because sometimes wet sanding with gun lube is really great. And I just love, I've been using this stuff since I did the first 80% 1911 build 2 years ago, almost 3 years ago at this point. And I just love it to death because, one, it's non-toxic, and number two, it doesn't have any type of odor to it. So you literally smell nothing. And I just always kept getting headaches with the other stuff. So I'll include a link, and I think I have a promo code for that. And then I'm also gonna be using a microfiber towel. Now, as this video progresses, if I pull out any other new tools that I might need to use, I will mention where they are, and I'll also include a link to those in the build list as well. And if you're new to this channel, we're not really allowed to link to all this stuff from YouTube. So if you follow the first link in the video description, it'll take you to another page where all the links to all the parts will be located. But if you're watching this on any other video platform, the links will already be in the description for you. Don't let this look intimidating, because it's not as intimidating as it looks, I promise. But we gotta write stuff down, and forgive my messy handwriting. But so basically at the top here, I drew out what the slide looks like from this angle right here, looking at these rails, okay? That's what I'm drawing. And then on the bottom, I have the frame drawn out as if we're looking at the rails up here. So keep that in mind as you're looking at this diagram. I drew out the slide right here. I took my calipers, and I'm using millimeters for those that are wondering, because I think millimeters are easier than the standard system when you're talking about thousandths of an inch. But you can use whatever system that you wanna use. You could use metric or imperial. But essentially what we have to do is we're gonna be manipulating these rails to fit this slide. We're not gonna be manipulating the slide. All the filing is gonna happen on the frame, just so you know. So what I went and did was I took my calipers here, and I'd measure out the width of here, and I would write that down. I would also measure it up here as well, just to verify that everything is consistent. And with that width, we were getting like a 16.35, 16.36. So right here, I just drew an arrow right here. That's my rail width. I wrote down 16.36 millimeters. I think that's what I measured the first time. And then right here is the channel width. And what that is I measured the width from here all the way to here. That's the channel right there. And that was, you know, 19.15 millimeters. I also measured the thickness of the rails down here like this. And I also wrote that down. I got 3.3 millimeters. And then I took my calipers and I measured on the inside of the channel to measure how thick or how tall the channel is. Then I went to my frame and I made those same measurements. I did my, you know, I measured my rail width right here. The interesting thing is you want to measure it on the front and the rear, because on the 2011s, we have two separate rail sections, whereas on like a 1911, this is a continuous piece. But you just want to make sure that you're uniform from the front all the way to the back. So the best way to do this would be, like, for example, measure it like right here, and then measure it right here, and then come to the back side, measure it up here, and then measure it back here. If you want to be like super, super accurate, that's the best way to do it. So I wrote down my width of 19.25 millimeters. And what that means is we're about 0.1 millimeters wider than the width of the channel. Remember, the width of the channel is 19.15, width of the rails, 19.25, which means we need to take approximately 0.05 millimeters off of each side of this to total 0.10. It's okay if we go a little bit over 0.10. Just know that the more you take off, the looser the tolerances will be, but sometimes looser tolerances tend to aid in reliability. And then I measured the width of the actual channel right here. So this channel width, I measured at the front and the back, and that channel width coincides with this width right here on the bottom part of the rails. And then I also took it and I went inside of here and measured that. So for example, we're getting 2.87 millimeters. Well, I've done determined that the thickness of these guys that's gonna fit into that channel is 3.3, which means the gap in our channel here is not quite wide enough, so we need to open that up. I hope this makes sense. I hope I'm not moving too fast, but essentially we just gotta match all these parts up. What I would do if I were you, you're not gonna use my numbers, but if you wanna like screenshot this so you can use it on your own, I'm totally cool with that. So then down here towards this bottom part, we basically create a start and a finish. So this is our frame that we're talking about down here. We're starting on a rail width of 19.25. So our rails on the outside to the outside are 19.25 millimeters, and we need to finish at 19.15, meaning we need to remove 0.10 millimeters. Okay, that's a big M. And which means that we need to divide that by 2 and remove 0.05 millimeters from each side so it's even. Makes sense? Our channel width right here is actually good. Our channel width was 16.6 millimeters, and the rail width up here was 16.36 millimeters. So what that means is we don't have to remove any material. And the one thing we do have to do, though, is we need to make this channel height a little bit bigger. What I mean by that is when we measure the thickness of our rails, we're getting like 3.25 millimeters. And then that thickness needs to coincide with the insides of these rails here. And when I measure that, I'm getting 2.95 right now. We need to remove approximately 0.3 to 0.35 millimeters from this underside of this rail on the top. We don't want to remove anything from down here or the inside of this channel, just this bottom lip all the way across. And I'll show you how we're gonna do that in a second. It's a method I've never used, so hopefully this will work. Now, if you're watching this on YouTube, I'm not gonna be able to show you exactly how to do this right now. So if you follow the first link in the video description, you will be able to see a full tutorial on me actually doing it. But if you're watching this on any other video platform, we're just gonna continue on. If you're on YouTube, however, you're about to see this and see how the final product came out. And then I'm gonna talk about some of the things I learned and some of the mistakes I may have made or may not have made. And with the power of editing, everything is done. So if you're watching this on YouTube, obviously I couldn't go through the how-tos of everything because of the rules that are on here, but we've done a lot, basically. If you go watch the tutorial, basically we finished two operations today, and I'm gonna show you some cool stuff here in a second. So we got everything filed down just using hand files, a little bit of sandpaper, and we used some of this shooter lube here. I always use a lot of lube when I'm building guns because it helps everything go together a lot nicer. And what I had to do was I got it about to like this point right here, and it would hit these back rails, and then I would take this nylon side, I actually gotta buy a new nylon hammer, and I would start hammering this off kind of like this until I could get it all the way off. I'd re-lube it, do it again. Not too bad. It's still a little stiff, but that's okay because we still have a ways to go before this gun's gonna be what I consider finished. Here's the mistake I made. When I was doing my measurements, I accidentally took a little bit too much off on this side, on that inside rail. That's not a huge issue for me because I am gonna be Cerakoting this and, you know, probably doing some kind of cool color with it. So that will probably disappear in the very near future. The other thing that we did, if you understand anything about 1911s, this is the gun that Brownell sent me so I could reverse engineer it. It's a Rock Island Armory TCM TAC Ultra, but it's the single stack, not the high capacity version. It only holds 10 rounds of 9mm or 10 rounds of 22 TCM. But it's basically the same slide. The only difference is the one that is on this gun says TCM. That's it. Everything else is the same. But this one has a standard barrel bushing on it. And you have to have a special tool which is integrated into the back of these bench blocks. I love these things. I will throw a link down to this bench block. This thing has been with me for 3 years now through every single build that I've ever done. And surprisingly, it's just held up like a champ. But this little tool down here will take this barrel bushing off. Well, when I tried the DVCP back in October, I saw something on it that I really liked. And I was like, man, I definitely need one of those in the future whenever I do a 2011 build. One, it had a bull barrel. A bull barrel is a barrel where it gets more fat as you go out to the end of it, right there. So you can see that. And what that does is it eliminates that barrel bushing and it totally fills up that hole, the gap where the barrel bushing would go. The problem is the barrel bushing is what holds the guide rod in. I got something called a reverse plug. Now this reverse plug is made by Rock Island Armory, but it's not made for this, for 9mm. It's only made for like their 10mm slides, I think. I ordered it anyway, because I was like, well, maybe I can modify it to fit, and thankfully, I was. If you see down inside of here, there was a little lip on the inside that basically prevented me from installing this like this, okay? It's still a little tight, I'm gonna work on it some more, but essentially, there's a tiny little lip down here, so I filed out that lip. It's in the tutorial whenever you go over there to watch. And it goes into place, right? So now, watch this. As we push this forward, watch this clip. It just releases. And now, we have a 9mm with a bull barrel and the reverse plug with a toolless disassembly. That is absolutely awesome. This is what makes some of the STIs cost so much. It's not that it costs a lot to do it yourself, it just, because somebody else did the research for you, that's what you're, voila. Let me know what you guys think of this. I think it looks dead sexy. I mean, obviously we're gonna be doing some cool Cerakote or some kind of colors to it. We're gonna do something to this barrel. I'm probably gonna flush cut this barrel as well. We got a lot to do in the next few videos on this, but I'm super stoked. We gotta do some blending on this as well. I'm still waiting on my hammer and sear to come in. If it doesn't come in time, I'm literally just gonna yank this hammer and sear off just to put in place so we can keep the series going in case it doesn't show up in time. This is gonna be an amazing John Wick blaster when I'm done with it. So instead of spending $4,000 or $5,000 for the John Wick blaster, we're gonna be doing something ourselves and probably have something that we can be more proud of than whether or not we went out and bought something that was really expensive. So let's jump up top real quick. I got a couple other things I wanted to talk about, and then we'll wrap up today's video. Back up top. All right, cool guys. So it really wasn't that bad. It did take me a little couple of hours to get all the filing done because we are using a steel frame instead of an aluminum frame like we used on the original 80% build that I did a couple of years ago. Aluminum is a lot softer and a lot easier to file and cut and things like that. But the main reason I didn't go aluminum frame for the 2011 is because our grip module is already going to be polymer. We are basing this off of the STI DVCP. I want a tactical 2011. I don't want a competition 2011. So it's going to look dead sexy when it's done. I can already see that. I mean, it's already looking really good. I'm very excited to move forward with this, but there is one thing that's holding us up from moving forward, and I'm going to talk about that in a second. Now, in regards to the bull barrel conversion, that really was probably the easiest part of this whole thing. Just grinding out that little lip that was on the inside, like I showed you. I'll include links in the build list where I got this guide rod, spring, and this reverse plug. But if you haven't watched the tutorial yet, this reverse plug wasn't made for the 9mm. It was made for the 10mm slides. And so I made it work. Now, it also fits onto the frame very nicely. As I showed you up close, I did make a little bit of a mistake on the rail on this side where there's a little bit of a gap. And like I mentioned up close, it doesn't bother me. I actually left a couple of gaps on this 80% build. Now, I would have left a little less of a gap, but I kind of got carried away and a little bit impatient with the filing. So it's not a huge deal. It's 100% fixable and the tolerances are still quite tight on this. It doesn't move side to side and it doesn't move up and down. The reason it doesn't bother me is we are going to be getting this frame and the slide recoated. I don't know exactly what we're going to coat it with yet. I haven't decided. I don't know if we're going to go DLC or if we're going to do some kind of Cerakote with it. Either way, Cerakote and DLC always adds a little bit of a thickness of a few microns of thickness to the finish. And so if you do have loose tolerances, they're now going to be tight. Whereas if the tolerances were already tight with bare metal, when you start adding coatings, they're going to be too tight. And that's something that I want to avoid. We are going to have to buy a special tool. And in fact, this is a special tool that I don't even own yet. I'm actually going to have to go get one in a minute. And that special tool is called a lower lug cutting tool. And the tool is not cheap, but it's 100% necessary. It's about $100 and something. It might be $150, $180. I do have promo codes for it and I will include it in the build list. The main reason we gotta buy this is when I put this little pin into place right here, you can see that our gun does not go into battery. So here's the front. It's not going all the way forward. It's due to this, where this hole is, it's due to these lugs on the barrel. Essentially what a lug cutting tool does is it gives you a faux guide rod and that guide rod puts pressure on the barrel so that the barrel is pushed completely against the top of the slide. That way we ensure we're cutting it correctly. Then there's also a little tool that inserts to the back of this frame and you put upward pressure which pushes this forwards. Then the cutter goes inside of this hole and as you're putting forward pressure, you turn this cutting tool. And what it does is you can basically watch it in real time. And as you can see right now, you know, it's not going into battery. But if we had that tool, I would just simply turn this tool as I'm putting pressure and we could watch this slide move forward and we can get it perfect. Therefore, we're always going into battery. The interesting thing about this is technically it is in battery. This barrel is locked up. The problem is how far back on the slide that it's located. So I'm gonna go get one of those lug cutting tools. That way we can take care of that. But don't worry, here in future videos, as I'm waiting for that lug cutting tool to arrive, we will start working on this lower right here. We'll start putting the pieces together and getting everything going. So then in case that lug cutting tool takes a while to get here, that could be another video. But I'm super excited about the way that this is going. Let me know what you guys think down in the comments. Now, in the first video of this series, I did mention that I was originally gonna pick up one of those Rock Island Armory Tac Ultra double stack 9mm, and I was gonna do a little bit of a customization on that. And the problem that I had is I've been looking for the past 6 months for one, and I haven't been able to find one in stock anywhere. Of the ones I found in stock, they wanted $150 to $200 more than MSRP, or people that were selling used ones wanted MSRP for them. And so I got this guy right here, brand new. This one is basically the same thing as the double stack, except it's a single stack. Now, I'm not gonna be customizing this one. This one is one that we're gonna be using for comparison purposes, and we're gonna be using for reverse engineering for this build. This way, I can look at this barrel, I can see how it fits to make sure that that barrel's fitting properly. I can also look at how the lugs fit and everything. And that's how I determined that we needed a lug cutter, was I started looking at this one, I'm like, yep, we're gonna need a lug cutter. This one holds 10 rounds of 9mm. It's essentially the same slide that we're using on the 2011. The day I picked this up, MrGunsnGear happened to be in town, and he had already told me he was coming into town and that we were gonna go out and shoot some guns, and this gun just happened to arrive. He actually kind of grabbed it and put the first 10 rounds through it at the range.
I shouldn't make this video, but we're about to. So yeah, 22 TCM, 1911, this one still has the 9mm in it. And we'll see how the very first shots from this gun go.
Well, it's accurate.
Yeah, it's definitely accurate, and no doubt about it, an all steel 9mm 1911, that's a sweet shooter.
You know, we didn't even clean this. We didn't even oil it up. We just yanked it out of the box. He put 10 rounds through it, bang, 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 zero malfunctions. Unfortunately, it only comes with one magazine, which is this, a 10 rounder. So every time you want to shoot it, we had to reload a new magazine. Prior to this, I'd never shot a single stack 9mm 1911. I have shot one 2011 that was a 9mm, which was the STI, but never just a standard 1911 in 9mm. This one also came with the 22 TCM barrel conversion, which is basically like a 22 caliber bullet that is kind of necked down in a 9mm casing, I think it is. Travels super fast, super light. I don't have any of that ammo. I didn't get it for that, but we might play with that in the future as well. But one thing is for sure, I think we put about 50 or 60 rounds through it. It was 5 or 6 mags, and we didn't have any issues with it. We didn't have any failure to fires. We didn't have any live primer strikes. The magazine worked just fine. So this is gonna be interesting to keep going and see how well this Rock Island Armory gun lasts. I believe these are around the $500 to $600 mark. And for that price, I mean, that's a hard gun to beat. The couple of things that I love about it is it has what's called the slab slide, where it's straight all the way across. Whereas, you know, on a standard 1911, the front of the slide is cut upwards, and I didn't want something like that. The other thing that I like about it is it does have a full length Picatinny rail, and that's something that's important to me. So if I had a single stack 9mm 1911, this is actually perfect. The only downside is I want a 2011 so I can have, you know, 20+1 rounds. And this one is a little bit heavier than what the 2011 is going to be, just because the grip of it is steel framed. So yeah, definitely a little heavier. Zero recoil hardly with this thing. One thing I did notice, and maybe it needs a little bit of a break-in period, is although it shoots super flat, I felt like it was a little bit bouncy on the recoil. And that could be because it's either A, oversprung a little bit, or B, we just got to break the spring in. So that's something that we're going to look at here moving forward. So I'm super excited to keep this build going. In the next video, like I said, we're going to be working on the lower, putting some parts into there. I'm still waiting on a couple of parts to arrive. And then as soon as the lug cutter gets here, we will start working on that. But if you're interested in the build list, like I said, follow the first link in the video description if you're watching this on YouTube, in case this is a build that you would like to do in tandem with me. But if you want to watch another cool video, I know this video is publishing on a Monday. You wanna be here on Wednesday because I have another epic build that I've never done on this channel before. When that video publishes, I will put a link either right here or right here so you can go watch that. Let me know what your questions are, but until next time, guys,